today, the summer of 17. That's right, 17 records I picked up this summer, representing a wide range of genres. All that and more coming up next. Hi, my name is Frank. Welcome back to Sundays on Channel 33 RPM, your channel for vinyl, gear, and more. Now, before we dive into this episode, this epic episode, it's going to go overtime. It's going to be longer, I'm sure, than I typically do for a video. I want to talk about a couple of things. First, I'm trying out a new microphone, a Rode mic, a new mic today. So let me know if it makes a difference, if it sounds any better. I would love to get your feedback on that too. And we've been talking about this one on the Facebook page this week. And that's some new merch I got in the Channel 33 RPM merch store. Anyway, it should speak for itself. Vinyl Make America Spin Again t-shirts. I got one in white and I have one in black. Now, of course, I am not American, but 50% of you, dear Channel 33 viewers, are watching from the States, so I feel that Channel 33 RPM is doing its part to help make America spin again. These are in the merch store. This is $11. The black one is $14. Check it out. Link below this video. Now, let's dive into this update. Now, into the update. First of all, I want to give a big shout out to Matt, who sent this first record over to me. And Matt is one of the guitar players and the singer for this super cool band called Dr. Smoke. And this is their 2015 release called The Witching Hour. First of all, Dr. Smoke has to be one of the coolest band names I've heard in a while and totally appropriate for the kind of music that these guys play. This is a glorious slab of Black Sabbath influence, doom metal, horror metal, or as they call it, occult rock. That means sludgy riffs and nasally vocals and lyrics that dabble in the unknown. Okay, let's take a look at this. First of all, the artwork for this here is super cool. You can see there, this was limited, by the way, to 500 copies. There's the front. My only observation is that it's kind of hard to see the band name there, Dr. Smoke, but nonetheless, I dig the album artwork. And inside, we had lyric sheet and a photo right there of the band. As for the vinyl itself, it comes on this smoky, sort of see-through-ish vinyl. Smoky, Dr. Smoke, kind of makes sense. There are 9 tracks on here. My favorite would have to be Blood and Whiskey with its grooving, sludgy, heavy riff and very catchy chorus, if I do say so. Anyway, this is definitely worth checking out. I will leave a link below. You can find Dr. Smoke on Bandcamp, buy their record there, support these guys, support indie rock. Now, all you Iron Maiden fans out there will know that the band has been reissuing a lot of their back catalog, all of their back catalog on vinyl, and you can buy these boxes to put your records in. I picked this one up. This came with 2 records inside of it, No Prayer for the Dying and Fear of the Dark. So the idea, I'm assuming from the band, is that you'll get this and you'll buy all the reissues and place them in here. I haven't bought them all, but I've been buying quite a few of them. There are all the ones available in this series of reissues, from No Prayer for the Dying to En Vivo. Of course, the Book of Souls is their latest release. I still have the filler in there. I haven't used the box yet, but I will show you what I picked up. I got a bunch of them, as you can see here. First off is the 1990 release from the boys, No Prayer for the Dying. This record doesn't necessarily get a lot of love, but I kind of dig it. I got good memories of this particular album. I saw Maiden that year. It was my first time seeing Maiden at some of the Winnipeg Arena Anthrax Open. There's maybe 2,500 people in a 12,000 seat arena, but that means I got pretty good seats. I also picked up the next album. This is Fear of the Dark. This one came out in 1992, and this was Bruce's last record with the band. He left after this, and then of course he returned triumphantly in 2000. Next 2 releases from Maiden I skipped. Those were the Blaze Bailey era records. I never really got into them, so after that I went right into Iron Maiden, Brave New World. This is their 2000 release, of course, where Bruce Dickinson returned and Adrian Smith returned. This is when they became a 6-piece with a trio of guitar players. This was a fantastic, fantastic comeback album. Now, I have to admit, everything that came out post Brave New World, I kind of skipped. I'm not really sure why. Just when they were coming out, I decided not to pay attention. So now I'm playing a bit of catch up here. So I got the next three Iron Maiden studio albums, including A Matter of Life and Death. This is another double album. There is the back, and here is the gatefold sleeve. We also have Dance of Death, and typically, I really love Iron Maiden album artwork, but this one, I'm not sure, kind of falls short of the style and the type and the quality of album artwork I expect from these guys. I'm not gonna say it's horrible, but it is pretty close. Finally, and these, I messed up the order of them, but this is Final Frontier, and this one came out in 2010. There is the inside, some cool, kind of cool images of Eddie, space age Eddie. Again, not my favorite Iron Maiden album cover, but definitely not the worst. And that one was also a two record set. I got three other records for you, and these ones would fall, I would say, under the category of jazz. This is not a genre that I'm super knowledgeable in, that I'm really familiar with. I'm just kind of learning, and I go, truthfully, I go to one of the local record stores here, and I kind of look in the jazz section, and they're reissuing a lot of the Blue Note releases, and I kind of read the liner notes in the back, and I kind of just figure out whatever kind of looks cool is what I grab. And as I said, I'm learning. I bought this one because of the really the album artwork and the title. This is called Back at the Chicken Shack. This is with the incredible Jimmy Smith. As I said, these are cheap. This was $18.95 Canadian, which is like $15 US. I also picked up this Blue Note reissue. This is True Blue, Tina Brooks. And this is kind of fun stuff to throw on the turntable sort of at the end of a Friday night or on a Sunday morning, that kind of stuff. I'm really digging it. And finally, from that same genre of jazz, we have Wayne Shorter with Speak No Evil. And this is one of the ones where I was kind of reading the liner notes, and that's what really sold me on this particular record. It really, it's right up my alley. It talks about, starts off saying, legends, folklore, and black magic. The arts of mystery and darkness have long been a special source of inspiration for artists. And then it talks about how this record was really inspired by the supernatural and all that sort of stuff, which of course piqued my curiosity and meant I was gonna grab it. Again, these are all reasonably priced. This one was $20 Canadian. What else do I have in the stack of records? I found this one. This one, I think, it wasn't a lot. It was maybe $5 or $6. This is the Jeff Healey Band. This is their second album. And for those of you not familiar with Jeff Healey, rest in peace, Jeff. He passed away some time ago, I believe, of lung cancer. But he's a Canadian guitarist from the Toronto area. He was blind, and he played his guitar flat on his lap. But this man could wail. Such a phenomenal, phenomenal guitar player. And a good singer, too. Really soulful voice. I always thought that his support band, the drummer and the bass player, were not nearly in his same league, in the same caliber. He was just phenomenal. Now, in case you think I've gone soft, I haven't. Here is some metal for you. It's a 2017 release from Accept. This, of course, is their latest album. And I'm really digging Accept so much nowadays. And these guys are really flying the heavy metal flag. And they've been doing this now for 40 years. And they're consistently putting up really, really good heavy metal records. And this one is no exception. The first time I heard it, I don't want to say I was disappointed, but I wasn't super pumped. But the more I listen to it, the more I'm getting into it. It was actually expensive here in Canada too. I think I paid like $40 Canadian for it, which is far too much for any record. But it is a two record set. This album is called The Rise of Chaos. And the band had some lineup changes of this record where their drummer and their second guitarist left. This was on Nuclear Blast, and it came on colored vinyl, which looks cool, but if you guys know me, I'm not really into the colored vinyl. It doesn't really mean a lot to me. I prefer black vinyl. I know a lot of you guys dig colored vinyl. I can kind of take it or leave it, but I will admit it does look pretty cool. As for the songs, one that really stands out to me is called Analog Man. I know you guys will relate to it. The lyrics really speak to how these guys grew up in a time when they listened to cassettes and records, and they're really behind the times, and they are analog men, and the whole world of cell phones and digital music really isn't for them. I think many of us can relate to that. This one here was a complete blind buy. You gotta love it when that happens. This is a band called Sinner, and the reason I bought it, well, because the band was called Sinner. This was an original 1984 pressing, and it says a metal direct from Germany. Now, this is not a German pressing. This is a Canadian pressing, and look at this. this heavy metal maniac woman there. I wouldn't classify her as necessarily as attractive. Maybe scary. I'm not sure. Anyway, I had to grab it. This is, you know, is it good? It's what you'd expect from, you know, B, maybe C level heavy metal. C level heavy metal coming out in 84. It's kind of generic, but it's entertaining. It's a good listen. It was on this Viper label, and I've only spun it once or twice, so I do want to give it some more listens. The album, by the way, was called Danger Zone. Changing genres once again, this is another record that I've wanted for a while. It's the Beastie Boys with Paul's Boutique. I bought this here in Winnipeg at a bookstore, a local bookstore called McNally Robinson. They actually have quite a good selection of records. I can't remember exactly what I paid for it, somewhere between $25 and $30 Canadian, which is $20 to $25 US. This is a single record, but it does have a pretty cool fold-out. It folds out four times. One, two, three, four. Sorry about the glare. And vinyl is black, and it comes with an insert with lyrics and credits on the back. So for those of you who follow me on social media, you will know that I like to go record shopping on my lunch break at work. I work downtown. There's a record store I visit once a week here in downtown Winnipeg called Into the Music. And a lot of times I don't find anything, but I found this one in the new arrivals bin. That's pretty happy to find. It's a 12-inch single, White Zombie Electric Head Part 2. This cost me $4.50, which I think is a steal of a deal, considering it is a white, if you can see that, it is a white label promo. And that, by that I mean it's on a white label. It says promotional only, not for sale. It's got some remixes and whatnot. And I'm a White Zombie fan. I'm a Rob Zombie fan. And believe it or not, this is the first White Zombie record I have in my collection. I got them all on CD, but nothing on vinyl. So I was happy to grab this. And I thought it was one of those albums they don't see every day. We are now going on record 16. And this is a local band from here in Winnipeg, called Harlequin, Victim of a Song. And I'm not sure if anyone outside Western Canada or outside of Canada is familiar with these guys, but it's kind of 70s, 80s radio rock. Some good stuff. If you grew up in this country, you've heard their tunes on the radio all the time, including Sweet Things in Life. They still play that on classic rock radio all the time. So this was cheap. It was $4. And the first Harlequin I have on vinyl. I got a CD, I got some tapes, but I didn't have anything on vinyl. So I'm going to start on my Harlequin vinyl collection. Now, this next one, I want to give a big shout out to Andy, aka YouTuber Cloudy Milder. He won a gift certificate from YouTube channel Golden Vinyl Spin. So Golden Vinyl Spin had a contest. Andy won it, and the prize was a $25 Amazon gift certificate. Andy lives in the UK, and the gift certificate was for Amazon Canada, and he found that he couldn't really, basically it would cost him $25 to ship anything from Amazon Canada to the UK, so he found no use for the gift certificate. So Andy then asked me if I could use it. Of course I jumped at it. So thank you, Andy, and thank you, Golden Vinyl Spin, indirectly for the $25. I will leave links to both of those channels below this video. Anyway, with that $25, I put it towards this next record, which is an album I've wanted for a long, long time, but it was always too expensive. I finally found it for $35 Canadian, which is $27, $28 US. And that is Metallica with Garage Inc. I know there's a lot of mixed views in this album. This is Metallica doing all cover songs. But I really like this record. It's a triple album. It's a three record set. And it's a gatefold. And there is the inside. That was my 17th record. That was 17. It's actually 18 in this video. So I lied. But this one is a record that many of you have asked about. Tina, I've listened to it so many times, both the record and through Spotify, streaming it in my vehicle. And that is Alice Cooper's new record called Paranormal. Now, this has gotten some mixed reviews and some folks saying that Alice Cooper's being too slick, and producer Bob Ezrin once again is doing the, what I call, everything in the, including the kitchen sink production technique, which means he just goes overboard, just does so many effects and whatnot that kind of takes away from the character and quality of music. But I mean, it's Alice. Any Alice is good Alice. I love Alice. And I mean, if you can look past that, I think in terms of the song structure and the feel of the songs, is really going for a 1970s feel that so happens to have 2017 production values. Great tracks on here, including Dead Flies, Fireball, Fallen in Love, and I Can't Get Up, Public Private Breakdown. I've listened to this album probably 30 or 40 times right now, and I honestly haven't gotten enough of it yet. So if you do own this, I'd love to get your opinion on it. If you haven't checked it out already, I would say it's definitely well worth checking out. Okay, those are my albums of the summer of 17. I thought they were 17, they turned out to be 18. Hey, one bonus record, what can I say? What did you guys think of today's episode in the comments below? What were some of your favorite pickups this summer? I would love to know, we would love to know. Let us know in the comments below. Remember, if you enjoyed today's episode, leave a quick like. If you haven't subscribed yet, click that button. You will never miss another episode again. And if you are so inclined, please do check out the merch store for those shirts I showed you, for shirts like this one, for tons more. I try to keep the prices as low as possible because, really, I like making t-shirts. I'm not doing it for the money. Guys, I hope you have a fantastic week. Until next Sunday, keep on spinning.
Iron Maiden!